Today, millions of people across the world are getting married at a very early stage. Now, we're talking about marriage below the age of 18, which has become a common issue in many countries. As a matter of fact, 1/3 of girls in developing countries are getting married at an early stage. This is no longer a surprise, and some, I'm sure, of the people who are watching us tonight will come to wonder if they did get married at a younger age, will come to wonder, have they made a mistake in marrying early? What's the solution? Don't worry. The only solution to this problem is that deal with it. Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome once again to our show, Deal With It, with me, your host, Ahmed Ali. Now, this show is dedicated towards discussing and analyzing some of the most controversial topics out there that affect our lives, whether negative or positive. Now, throughout the show, you will be given the chance to call, comment, and ask your questions. For Sayid Hussein Al-Qazwini is joining us tonight to talk about the pros and cons of early marriage and to answer whatever question you have. Sayyidina, assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
How are you?
Alhamdulillah.
Allah khalikum, inshallah. Allah yasalimkum.
Allah
yasalimkum, inshallah. Before we get into the discussion, let's kick it off.
Give our salams to the imams. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليكم مني جميعا سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين والسلام على أخيه أبي الفضل العباس باب الحوائج السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته.
ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن قامت لو أجل ويا لم يزليس إن قامت لو أجل ويا لم يزليس روشن همي آفاق أزين نور جليس روشن همي آفاق أزين نور جليس ايشيه بخد ببال ولبخن بزن ایشیه به خود به بال و لبخند بزن میلاد همایون حسین ابن علی هنگام طلوع جلوه لم یزلیست هنگام طلوع جلوه لم یزلیست روشن همه آفاق از این نور جلیست روشن همه آفاق از این نور جلیست ایشیه به خود به بال و لبخند بزن ایشیه به خود به بال و لبخند بزن میلاد همایون حسین ابن علی میلاد همایون حسین ابن علی میلاد همایون حسین ابن علی.
Respected viewers, once again, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I do welcome you once again to our show, Deal With It, with me, your host, Ahmed Ali. Now, tonight, it's a very controversial topic. Some are against it and some are with it. It's early marriage. Now, do comment below. We are live on Facebook. Do comment below which are the pros and which are the cons, according to what you think about early marriage. Inshallah, we'll get to mention them throughout the episodes. And do not forget to comment and question as well. Sayyidina, once again, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. You know, I congratulate you once again on this very auspicious occasion. We celebrated the birth of Imam Hussein yesterday by talking about the pros and cons of social media. It was a fun topic. You guys can go check it out on our YouTube channel and also on our Facebook. And today, We chose to talk about early marriage. Now, to everything, to every controversial topic, there are pros and there are cons. Some people are for it, some people are against it. Now, before we get into personal, what are the pros of early marriage?
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. Anyone familiar with Islamic teachings, Islamic أخلاق, would know that Islam encourages marrying at a young age and not delaying marriage. There's lots of traditions, lots of ahadith that let your daughters marry early. Let your young sons marry early. وَأَنْكُحُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ وَإِمَائِكُمْ. Ayama means youth. Youth. They're still young. وَأَنْكِحُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ. This is an order. وَأَنْكِحُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ. It's an order, but it's a recommended. For a recommended deed, not wajib. So there's a lot of emphasis in Islam on marrying early. When we study the lives of the Prophet, the Imams, Ahlul Bayt in general, we see that many of them married at a young age. Fatima Zahra was very young when she got married. Imam Ali was young when he got married. Rasulullah was an exception, of course. He got married at the age of 25. And his first wife, Khadija, alayhi salam, there's a difference in opinion, on what her age was.
A lot of people would say we can't compare ourselves to, you know, to the infallibles.
That's what I wanted to say. That these narrations that emphasize on marrying young, are they general for all times? Or do they apply to certain times and places while they're not applicable at other times and places? Are they contextualized? Do we have to contextualize them? Meaning that when the Prophet says, let your daughters marry at a very young age, did this have a specific context? Does it only apply to the Arabian Peninsula, in Arabia, in a tribal system, when, you know, where there were no school, there were no schools, you know, daughters remained at home, they were basically enslaved, they were forced to do housework, house chores, or was it better for them to get married and become mothers and you know, and have a family? Perhaps we might be able to contextualize some of these narrations and say that, you know, Rasulullah and the Ahlul Bayt, when they encouraged getting married at a young age, they were looking at, you know, those specific times, because at those times that worked the best. This is one opinion, and another opinion says no, that getting married at a young age is a good thing at all times and all places, not just during the time of the Prophet. During our times, it's also a good thing. This is a difference of opinion. It's a difference of reading, you know, how you interpret these narrations and how you see them.
But according, I think, to the first opinion you mentioned, basically it's safe to say that, you know, if times are good, if simple, then okay. If times are hard, then of course a person can't marry. And in the times we live in today, it's extremely difficult.
It's not easy. We'll get to that. When we talk about the cons of marrying early, we can discuss that. But let's see, what are the pros?
Yes.
You know, let's say a young man, you know, mid-20s, early 20s, a young girl, early 20s, they want to get married. Is this a good idea or is it a bad idea? Number one, it could be a good idea. Why? Because marriage requires sacrifice. And it requires
compromises.
It can't be your way or the highway. It can't, you know, you can't always have it your way. There's some things that you have to give up. For example, young men and women that, you know, sleep very late at night. They sleep maybe 4 in the morning, 5 in the morning. You know, you don't have any responsibilities. You wake up noon, 11, 12.
It's amazing.
You're free. It's amazing.
Amazing.
Because you're free, you know, there's no responsibilities. You have nothing to worry about. But when you get married, obviously that's going to change. You have to go to work. 7 a.m. you have to be up, if not 6. Which means you have to sleep by 10 or 11. There's things that you have to change. You become a parent. You have to sleep early, to wake up early, to get your kids ready to go to school. Now, who is most likely to be able to adjust? Who is most likely able to adjust better to a married life? Someone who's in his early 20s, mid-20s, who hasn't picked up too many habits and can change his habits, or someone in his 40s who's, you know, who's lived, you know, a lifetime of spending, you know, the night out, staying up, sleeping in, you know, having, or for let's take smoking, for example. Mm-hmm. You get married to someone who doesn't want you to smoke. Who is more able to quit smoking? Someone who's 24 or someone who's 44 or 34? Obviously, the younger you are, the quicker you are to be able to put off a bad habit, you know, mm-hmm. to stop a bad habit. Because if you're 24, you might be smoking for the past 3-4 years. But if you're 44, that means you've been smoking for
at least
20 years, 24 years. That's a lot to leave a habit. You know what I mean? So marrying young, you'll be able to adjust and conform to your spouse's needs better than someone who's older, someone who can't change habits. You know, I see couples that they decide to divorce. Why? Because they just can't stop a habit. They can't stop a habit. They've been doing it for so long that they can't stop. You know, a lot of young guys nowadays, whether it's in the East or the West, they have a tendency to go to a shisha shop at night and hang out with friends. That's fine if you're a bachelor. But once you're married and you have duties and responsibilities, that's not practical to do it every day. But if you're used to doing it every day for the past decade or 2 decades, and now your wife tells you, you know what? Put your friends aside for the weekend.
Put the hookah aside
and your friends aside. And I want your time for me mm-hmm. and your family and children. Who is more able to adjust and compromise? Obviously, when you're younger. Mm-hmm. I don't think anyone will disagree with this. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean that if you're in your 40s, you can't adjust.
It all goes back to will, I think.
It goes back to will. But who has it easier?
Well, of course, the individual who's younger.
The younger one. Who hasn't picked up too many bad habits.
Yes.
Let me give another example. You marry someone, and there's some people that are used to cursing. They use profanity. And it's an addiction.
It
becomes a bad habit. You marry someone and says,
No.
Not in my house. Not in my house. Who's able to adjust better? Someone who's 25 or someone who's 45? Obviously the younger one. Because he still hasn't been molded. You could mold them easily. Right? But mm-hmm. the one who's old, it'll be very to put a bad habit aside.
Definitely. As the saying goes, right? Whoever, you know, is nurtured at a young age was, you know,
with a certain habit, then it'll stick to it. And there's another saying in Arabic that says, "العادة العادة في البدن لا يغيرها إلا الكفن."
Wow.
A habit that sticks is a habit that won't change until death, until the kafan changes it. Meaning it'll stick mm-hmm. to death. And marriage is all about compromise. Mm-hmm. It's all about leaving the things that you want for the people that you want. Mm-hmm. Leaving the things that you love for the people that you love. Mm-hmm. Things that aren't so important that you could do without. Mm-hmm. The younger you are, the easier it would be. Mm-hmm. This is one of the pros of marrying young. Another pro or another advantage is self-protection. Protection against shaitan, protection against the nafs, and nafs al-amara bis-su. That is why, you know, narrations say
things we talked about yesterday.
Ahsant. You know, shaitan is always there. Al-nafs al-amara, you know, our self that tells us to commit sin. Temptation. Mm-hmm. Temptation. We're tempted to commit a sin. But with marriage provides protection. That is why narrations say, من تزوج فقد أحرز نصف دينه. Or in another narration, فقد أحرز ثلثي دينه. He who marries has protected half of his faith, mm-hmm. has ensured half of his faith. فليتق الله في النصف الآخر. Let him be pious regarding the other half of religion. Half of his religion has been protected. Half of his faith has been protected. In another narration, 2/3 of his faith has been protected. Mm-hmm. Let him be pious with the other third. you know, you're not seduced easily when you're married. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided you an outlet for sexual gratification. Mm-hmm. When you're not married, you could easily fall. You could easily fall into the trap of shaitan.
Some people would disagree. I mean, to a certain extent, yes. When you get married, you tend to settle down. You know, you don't have that the extra energy that you used to have before getting married. But men still, I mean, that level changes between men or varies between men.
Right.
You know, some men, they can't settle down for one woman.
Right. Well, first of all, we're talking about men and women.
Yes.
This is one. Two, you're talking about a minority of men. But great majority of men, when they have a wife that they've chosen,
yes,
they're attracted to, mm-hmm, there's no issues. It wasn't an arranged marriage. They weren't forced to marry that person. They're attracted to that person. Usually, they shouldn't be wandering elsewhere, looking for other opportunities. What they have at home should be satisfying enough. Now, if there's a person that has greed that can't get enough, then, you know, that's another story.
That's their problem.
That's their problem. But marriage is supposed to solve a great deal of that problem. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, I don't want to oversimplify, but I want to give an example. If you have food at home, most likely you're not going to go look for food anywhere else.
Yeah.
You're not going to go steal food. You have food at home. Who's going to go steal food? The person who doesn't have food at home. The one who's starving at home will go and steal. But if you have all kinds of food at home, there's no need for you to go.
What an example.
I don't mean to, you know, obviously there's a difference. Obviously there's a difference.
I think it's pretty close.
It's almost close. I don't mean to oversimplify. Mm-hmm. But once you're married, you've secured yourself.
Yeah.
Now, if you're wandering somewhere else, then there's a problem.
Yeah.
There's some sort of problem in the marriage, or in attraction.
Yeah.
There's some sort of problem. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you should be secure, both the man and the woman. This is big.
It is.
You know, when you're young, when I say teenager, 19, 20, early 20s, you know, the sexual desires that you have are not like a person who's in his 40s and 50s.
Yeah.
These desires need to be met. They're either going to be met in a halal way or a haram way.
Yes.
It's a need. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put this need in human beings.
Mm-hmm.
And He's provided the halal outlet. He's provided marriage in a halal way. So this is a major advantage to marriage, that it protects you. It doesn't let shaitan trick you any longer. Mm-hmm. You know, in Arabic, in Iraq, they say that marriage is a form of sitr. So it covers. It protects you. You don't need to wander anywhere else, right?
Wow.
So this is a big advantage. It's a major advantage to marrying early.
Mm-hmm.
Did you want to?
I think one of the pros into if you're done that point.
Sure.
One of the pros within getting married at a very young age is the role, the active role you have within the life of your children if you have at a young age. It's different, you know, when you're 20 and you have a child, or, you know, early 20s and you have a child. When you're 30, they're, you know, gonna start playing sports, so on and so forth. So you're still young, you're still active. But when you have a kid, you know, later on in stages, for the people that do get married in 30, 35 years old, when they're 45, they can barely, you know, their back hurts, or their neck hurts, they can barely play sports, then they will see what the pros and cons of marrying early is.
Playing sports is one aspect of
one
it.
One aspect.
There's so much to it.
But I mean the active role within the life of the child.
I totally agree, and that's one of the points that I have right here in front of me. First of all, when you marry at an older age, the amount of children immediately reduces.
Mm-hmm.
If you marry at the age of 35, and your spouse is also at the age of 35, a female is at the age of 35, how many children can she have after getting, married at the age of 35?
Five.
Up till 40, is it? 40, 45?
It's actually 53.
53 scientifically.
Yeah.
But who's having children at the age of 53?
I don't know. I haven't.
Usually after 42, 43, they stop. Right? So from 35 to 42, how many children do they want to have?
Two.
Maximum two.
I think it's enough though. I mean, two.
If that's what you want, if two children is what you want, that's fine. Mm-hmm. So this is one. It depends on what you want. But yeah, if you want four, five children, maybe more, I don't know, six, seven, it depends on the family, their energy, their financial capabilities. It all depends. Mm-hmm. I'm not, you know, calling for quantity.
Yeah.
You know, have plenty of children. No, I firmly believe that it's about quality. If you have two good children, it's better than having seven children that you can't raise. But my point is, if you want more children, you have to start young, mm-hmm, as well. This is one. Two, it's not just about playing sports. It's about connection as
yes,
well. When there's a big age gap between you and your children, for example, you're 35 or 40. If you're a 40-year-old man and you have a child, there's a 40-year gap between you and your child. This will reduce the amount of what you can talk about with your children.
Yes.
When your child is 10, you're 50. When your child is 20, you're 60. There's a big difference between a 60 and a 20-year-old. 20 years old, you know, he's becoming an adult. He's becoming a man. He wants to enter the world. You know, he's graduating from college. He wants to start working. You're 60. There's not a lot that you could relate to. A 60-year-old with a 20-year-old.
Yeah.
But if the age difference is 25, there's a lot you can speak to. When you're 20, or when he's 20, you're what?
45.
That's not a big difference. That's like an older brother. There's a lot that you could relate to. At 45, you're still young, and your child is, your son is 20. There's a lot that you could talk to. There's a lot that you could relate to, right? It's about connection.
It looks good when you have like young parents instead of old parents that, you know.
It's not just about looking good. It's about having that connection.
Yeah.
Connecting with your children, knowing how to speak to them, relating to them. You tell them, listen, I've been what you've been through, and you could overcome this problem. You could overcome this obstacle. You could find a job. But when you're 60 and he's 20, there's not so much in common between you. You see? And that's going to create a gap between you and your children. The older you are, the bigger the age difference, the bigger the gap.
Yes.
The younger you are, the smaller the gap, the more you could relate to your children. This is something that we need to pay attention to. Mm-hmm. Plus, the older you are, you know, you have to teach your children. When you're old, you can't teach them. You don't have the energy. You don't have the strength. You're not in the mood to come and teach them and, you know, explain everything to them. This is halal. This is haram. Why is this halal? Why is that haram? Having them stand next to you, pray. You're not going to have that energy. Mm-hmm. You're not going to be in the mood.
That's why they shift somewhere else.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. But inshallah, we'll get to touch upon this more after the break, if you will, inshallah.
Sure,
so respected viewers, do stay tuned for we'll continue the discussion around marrying early marriage. But after this short break, so do stay tuned.
Peace and blessings of Allah be upon you all. Welcome to the holy land of Karbala. Respected viewers, welcome to the area between the holy shrine, or between the holy shrines, or as it locally known, Bain al-Haramain. This area witnessed recently the opening of Karbala International Book Fair, that is a part of Rabi' al-Shahada Festival, the 13th edition of Rabi' al-Shahada Festival, that is held under the sponsorship of Imam al-Hussein and Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. peace be upon them, holy shrines. Respected viewers, stay tuned for further details and information about the book fair and about the activities of this book fair. Stay tuned, dear brothers. From the area between the holy shrines of Imam Hussein and his brother Abu al-Fadl Abbas, peace be upon them. Respected viewers, this book fair is held on the area of 3,000 square meters in the participation of 165 international publishing houses that are, you know, are displaying numerous topics and subjects, merely law, literature, philosophy, sciences, in addition to, of course, religion. Respected viewers, in the same context, Imam Hussein TV Group announced the participation in this book fair with a special booth that identifies the objectives of the group channels. Respected viewers, stay tuned. We will go to that booth and we will get to know more details about what they do, what the brothers are doing there in that booth. Stay tuned, dear brothers. Assalamu alaikum, respected viewers, back to you from Karbala International Book Fair, where we are now at Imam Hussein TV Group booth that displays the channels to the visitors of this booth. Right now I have here my brother. He is the director of IHTV Group booth, who is going to tell me about the activities of this booth and about the visitors of this booth. Assalamu alaikum, akhi al-aziz. ممكن تحدثني عن هذا الجناح وشنو فعاليات هذا الجناح إضافة إلى زوار هذا الجناح؟
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. حرصا من مجموعة قنوات إمام الحسين على التواصل مع الفعاليات الثقافية والاجتماعية في كربلاء والدينية أيضا، انفردت بالجناح خاص في معرض الكتاب المقام في منطقة بين الحرمين كوسيلة للتواصل الجماهيري، بالإضافة إلى دراسة رجع الصدى الإعلامي. المجموعة انفردت من خلال هذا الجناح بعرض مجموعة من الشاشات اللي تبث القنوات الخاصة باللغات العربية والفارسية والإنجليزية بالإضافة إلى التركية. زوار الجناح تباينوا بين شخصيات فكرية وثقافية واجتماعية وسياسية بالإضافة إلى فئات مختلفة من المجتمع العراقي وزوار من خارج العراق.
Respected viewers, my brother here just said that IHTV has taken a booth inside Karbala International Book Fair in order to display the activities of the channel merely through the screens appearing right behind me, you know, displaying the different programs of the channels. In addition to that, you know, IHTV is always IHTV TV Group is always, you know, concentrating on communicating with the visitors, on communicating with the audience in order to get to know their opinions and their advices, and if they have any ideas or plan in order to add it. In addition to that, a number of public, cultural and social figures, in addition to masses of the lovers and Shias of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, have visited this booth and prepared and gave their opinions and their advices and plans for the channel. Respected viewers, stay tuned. We will go around the book fair in order to get to know to the different activities and different publishing houses and their topics and subjects, the topics and subjects they are displaying. Stay tuned, dear brothers. Respected viewers, back to you from Karbala International Book Fair, where more than 165 publishing houses, international publishing houses, are taking part in order, you know, to display numerous and different subjects, merely about cultural subjects, theological subjects, philosophical subjects, and whatsoever. Respected viewers, we are at the booth of Ibn Fahd al-Hilli, where, you know, Ibn al-Fahd al-Hilli Publishing House are displaying the books that, you know, are published and that are written, sorry, by the Shirazi family. We have here different books written by, you know, different members of the Shirazi family, and also the representatives of the Shirazi religious authorities. We have here Sheikh Abdul Rida Ma'ash publications, in addition to a number of publications by the late Grand Ayatollah Sayyid Muhammad al-Shirazi, in addition to the Grand Jurist Sayyid Sadiq al-Husseini al-Shirazi. Respected viewers, we will go now to Al-Marja'iyya channel, where, you know, where it is another, you know, another media group by affiliated to the Grand Ayatollah Shirazi, you know, Shirazi office. This channel and you know, that booth particularly are, you know, displaying a number of the Shirazi family publications, in addition to the different activities of Al-Marja'iyya channel. Stay tuned.
Welcome back, respected viewers. We do thank Brother Muhammad Ali for going around Bain al-Haramain and reporting what is going on in these days with the book exhibition or the book fair here We do advise if you are in Karbala, go check that out because it's pretty nice. Now, I want to kick off the second part. Sayyidina, one second, assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
I want to kick off the second part of tonight's episode with questions we received on Facebook. We do advise to send any question or any comment you want, or if you want to just comment according to you, what is the proper pro or you think is a good pro for getting married early, or the con for that as well. Now, one of the questions, Sayyidina, is Am Rida Charrakh. He says, it's a pretty nice name. How about financial side? The older you are, the more money you make. Now, through this, I don't know what he's trying to get at, but I think he means that the older you are, you can
have more money.
Exactly. So you can, you know, support your family more.
Sure. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. From what I see with a lot of youth, mm-hmm. when I travel to the US, Europe, mm-hmm. you know, UK, France, Netherlands, a lot of the places that I go, and I talk about marriage with a lot of youth, and I see that, you know, there's a trend of delaying marriage to the 30s. Why? With the excuse that if I'm young, that means I don't have money. I barely work. I'm barely making enough money, so let me graduate and maybe go for a master's, maybe go for a PhD, find a job, maybe hop.
Isn't that the right though?
I'll get to that. Hop from one job to another, make enough money, buy a house, and then I'll get married. By that time, you're in your 30s. You're in your mid-30s. By the time that you're financially stable and you own a house and you have a steady job and a steady income, you're in your mid-30s. How many people have a steady job? How many people own a house nowadays? There's a lot of people in their 30s and they're still renting, especially in Europe. Europe yeah. It's extremely expensive to own a house. It's extremely expensive, even in the US, even in Canada. To own is almost impossible.
Majority,
you have to
be in
your 30s or yeah. 40s, late 30s. 40s mm-hmm. to own. So how long is it that you want to wait? How long is it that you want to wait? I'm not saying go out and get married and you only have $5 in your pocket. That's not fair either. That's not being realistic. But if you have a job, you have income, money's coming, might not be a lot, but you get married and you marry someone who's, you know, someone who's not too needy. And that's another problem, unfortunately. Nowadays, yeah. if not the girl, her parents.
Yeah.
We want our daughter in a private house, in an independent house. You can't be living with your parents. It can't be an apartment. She has to have her own car. She has to...
Come on.
What are you doing? You're reducing the chances of your daughter getting married. Let's make it easier on the youth. You don't have to be rich in order to get married. Plus, the Quran says... وَأَنْكِحُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ وَصَالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ وَإِمَائِكُمْ إِنْ يَكُونُوا فُقَرَاءَ يُغْنِيهُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. If they're poor, Allah will assist them. Allah will help them. Whatever happened to التوكل على الله, depending on Allah. Why is it that we're always depending on, you know, worldly reasons? I have to have a job. As if, you know, it's my boss that's giving me, providing me. It's not my boss. It's Allah. Allah is providing me through my boss. Allah is providing me through my job. It's mm-hmm. not my job, and it's not my boss, and it's not even my potential. It's all on Allah. Mm-hmm. But we don't realize this.
We don't, Sayyidina, I can agree with you 100%. But the thing is, if you don't have a stable job, I mean, for example, a person working at McDonald's cannot raise a family. And this is reality. A person making $9, $8 and a half, even $10, $11 an hour,
right,
won't be able to raise a family.
So what is this person waiting? He's waiting to be the CEO of Microsoft or Apple?
No.
That's not going to happen overnight. This person has to get married to feel responsible. To feel responsible, that sense of responsibility will push him to go out and find a better job. To go out and get an education.
What if he ruins his life with that decision?
Which decision?
Of getting married when he's not able to.
No, I don't think that will happen, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all merciful. And plus, we're speaking to whom? Youth in the West. land of opportunity. America is the land of opportunity. Canada is the land of opportunity. The West is the land of opportunity. Anyone can achieve. As long as you're determined, you have a strong will, you go out and get an education. You could study in the morning, work in the evening. Work in the morning, study in the evening.
Yes.
Go get an education, go get a job, you'll get a promotion. Anyone can achieve. Being lazy is not an excuse in the West. Oh, well, I haven't finished my degree. I'm not finding a right job. You're not finding the right job because you're not looking at the right place. You don't have the right credentials. Go get the right credentials. Go get the right degree. You'll get the right job. You'll make enough money. You'll get married. We need to stop making excuses, to be honest. I hear a lot of youth, they say, well, it's too soon for me to get married. Let me get settled. Let me find a steady job. Let me own a house. Well, by that time, you're in your 40s. You've missed the train. And let's be realistic. When you're 40, who's going to marry you? All the young ladies, the attractive ones, they're taken. If you're in your 40s, a girl that's in her 20s, 22, 23, she's not going to she's not going to want you, someone who's 20 years older. The longer you wait, the less options you have. And the same thing goes for young women. I see a lot of young women, they put off marriage. They say, no, let me get my education. Let me get my PhD. Let me work. When I'm in my 30s, I'll get married. Let's be realistic.
You know
when
why?
You're in your 30s, men your age are not going to be looking for someone your age. They're going to be looking for someone 10 years younger than you. That's the reality. A man in his 30s wants a woman in her 20s, not someone his age. I might be harsh. I might be harsh in saying this, but someone has to say it. This is the harsh reality. Don't put off marriage. Go get an education. You could be a female. Get your education. No one will stop you. You want a PhD? Get your PhD. You want to work? Go work. But that doesn't mean you have to, put off marriage. Doesn't mean that you have to delay marriage. You could do both. Yes, I'm sorry.
Now, what goes to that, Jasmine from the U.S., he says, we can't really, to comment on your ladies should, not put off marriage. She says men, the majority of the men will try to quit the ladies or their wives from their jobs or their studies to focus on house chores. And this is evident. I mean, we see that.
This is some men. This is some men. I mean, not all men are like this.
Not all, but the majority say it then.
No, I disagree. Not the majority. On the contrary.
For me, I see the majority.
I see a lot of men nowadays, they want their wife to study. They want her to work. Why? Because nowadays life is expensive. In Europe, in America, life is expensive. You need double incomes. You need two incomes. One that comes from the husband, one that comes from the wife in order to pay the bills. If you want to live a good life in the West, own a house, have two cars, pay the bills, have a vacation once in a while, once a year, at least once a year, on the weekend, go see a movie, go have a dinner once a week, or maybe once every 2 weeks, you need a good paying job, and you can't do that by yourself. There's a lot of young men nowadays that prefer to have their wife work. So, yeah, there might be some men that refuse their wife, their woman from working. But now there's a great deal of men that do want their wives to work. And not just in the West, even here in Iraq, there's a trend now. When they go and propose, they ask, did she finish college? Is she planning on working?
Yes.
Because we want her to work.
Yes.
So, plus you set conditions. When you marry someone, you set a condition that I'd like to continue my education. I'd like to pursue my education.
Yes.
I'd like to work. And a husband cannot stop his wife from working. Even if she doesn't put that condition. A husband cannot stop his wife from working or from seeking an education. Yeah, he has no right to stop her from that.
Of course.
So, where were we? You don't need to put off marriage. In fact, this is one of the pros that I forgot to mention. One of the pros of marrying young is moral support. Is moral support. As a young man, you want to become a doctor. You got your bachelor's, Now you want to go on to medical school.
Yeah.
You might do it, you might not do it. You know, there's so many obstacles. You have to get a loan. There's so much competition out there. You might have to apply out of state, out of country. But if you have a wife who's patient, who's supportive,
yeah,
we'll tell you, you know what? You could do it. Apply here, apply there. I'll come with you, wherever you. That's moral support. You know how big that is for a husband?
Definitely.
And same goes for the wife. If she has a strong husband, a supportive husband that will support her no matter what, in whatever she does in her career or his career, they're there to support one another. That wife can help you get a better job and get that promotion that you've always wanted and get that PhD that you've always wanted but you've been putting it off.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a good supporting wife, she could help you do it.
Yes.
But without that supporting wife, you might do it, you might not do it.
Mm-hmm.
You might be discouraged just like that.
Yes.
The smallest thing could put you off.
Definitely, especially
so
a woman
moral with, support.
With you know, with all due respect, with a big mouth, sometimes they can, you know, discourage the man. Another question that we have is Shafiqa. She says, why marry early and occupy your life with responsibilities when you can build a good, when you can build a good future and raise a proper family?
I don't see, you know, where the contradiction is.
Mm-hmm.
You could raise a proper family at, you know, when you're young, when you're in your early 20s. Now, let me define what I mean by young.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want people to think that I'm
17, 16.
17, 16. No, that's young.
This goes on to the second question. What age do you think is a good age for marriage and why? So this these two are somehow.
I say early 20s, mid 20s.
Mm-hmm.
Early 20s, mid 20s. However,
max, mid 20s, max?
No. Let me say this.
Yeah.
It all depends on that person. It varies from person to person.
Mm-hmm.
A person could be 25, but he has a brain of a 15-year-old. Let's face it.
Yeah.
There's some people that are immature.
Yeah, they're childish.
They're 25, yet they're still playing Xbox.
Come on, Sayyidina.
Hours a day.
Huh, okay.
Hours a day.
Good, good.
Not 30 minutes.
Okay, good.
I'm not saying playing Xbox is haram. But if you spend several hours of your day playing Xbox,
yeah.
You play Xbox?
Oh, PS3.
I know we decided not to ask personal questions.
But no. It's okay. I play PS4, so we're
but good. I'm sure you don't play it 4 hours a day.
We're getting personal, I'm saying that.
Yeah. Let's draw lines. But I'm sure you don't play Xbox 5 hours a day.
Oh, definitely not.
But there are some youth, they're 25, they're 29,
yeah.
They're 30. But they're still playing Xbox every day.
Yeah.
They have to have their soccer match every 2 days. You know, every other day. They have to go smoke hookah every night. Come on, grow up. You're reaching your 30s. You know, there's a time when you have to say, enough is enough. I have to grow up. I have to become responsible.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're that type of person, age is nothing but a number. You could be 35 and you're still immature. So I would have to really say it's about maturity.
Mm-hmm.
It's about a sense of responsibility. If you're 25 and you're still not responsible, then that's a problem. Do not get yourself into a marriage where you can't even, if you can't even take care of yourself, there's no way you can take care of a family.
Mm-hmm.
There's people in their late 20s and they, you know, their mom still washes their laundry.
Yeah.
They have to cook for them.
I know some.
They have to fix their bed for them.
Yeah.
Their sheets. Their.
Come on.
If you can't take care of yourself, you can't take care of a family. It all comes back to responsibility. A 19-year-old, believe me.
Like Sukhni. He's not 19, but... but yeah, sorry, go ahead.
Anyway.
Anyway.
You could be 19... You know, I hope Sufni's not listening to this.
You don't get mad, bro.
You know, at 19, someone at 19 could be more mature than someone at 29.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah.
So it's all about maturity. I say I cannot tell you when to get married. I can't. You know, if you're mature, if you feel responsible, if you are willing to compromise and sacrifice and go into a family and build a family, raise a family, go and get married, even if you're 20. I wouldn't encourage below 20. I wouldn't encourage below 20 because, you know, below 20, you're still not, you know, responsible enough.
Oh, okay.
You're not responsible enough. But if you feel responsible and mature, go ahead. And if you're 30 and you're still immature and you're still thinking about yourself, don't get married. So it all goes back to maturity and mm-hmm. how responsible you are and how willing you are mm-hmm. to raise a family and build a family. Mm-hmm. Jasmine, her question. Can we go back to Jasmine's question?
Jasmine's question.
The question before age. Or yes. Shafiqa, I'm sorry.
I think all of them, and somehow, this is it, but somehow they're all linked to financial support. Mm. I mean, we got Dawood from Canada. I'll ask this question later. We have only like 2 or 3 minutes.
Sure.
But Shafiqa's question says, why marry early and occupy your life with responsibilities when you can build a good future and raise a proper family?
I want her to understand that my point is, don't get married early for the sake of getting married early. No, you have to feel mature and responsible.
And the proper time.
These are two main conditions. Absolutely. Two main conditions. If these two conditions are not met, don't go for it. Don't get married at an early age. Be mature and feel responsible. Go ahead and do it. If you can get married at 22, 23, don't delay marriage till you're 30. You'll regret it later on. Start a family. Have children. Having children is beautiful. Protect yourself. Protect yourself against temptation. Plus, mm-hmm. the older you get, the lower chances you have.
Mm-hmm.
And the less opportunities you'll have. The less choices you'll have.
Yeah.
When you're 25, for example, you'll have 15 choices. But when you're 30, the 15 choices become 10. When you're 35, the 10 choices become 5. When you're 40, you're left with one choice. Or two choices, maximum. Right? Mm-hmm. Maybe I'm over-exaggerating, but that's mm-hmm. how it is. So, maturity, responsibility. If you feel responsible enough to get married, depend on Allah. You don't have enough money. If you're broke, that's another story. But if you're working hard, you're responsible, you could make rent, go ahead. Depend on Allah, and Allah will be there mm-hmm. for you to support you in raising that family.
Mm-hmm. Now, the last question for tonight, I know we talked about a lot. Did you face any obstacles when you first got married?
Everyone faces obstacles.
Mm-hmm.
There's no one that has it perfect. Mm-hmm. There's always obstacles in getting married. The first obstacle is, you know, maybe the financial question.
Mm-hmm.
What am I going to do?
See, it's always financial, Sayyidina.
Yeah.
It's
you know, when you're by yourself, you could eat fast food. You could eat one meal a day, you won't die. But once you're in a marriage, you're going to have to think of two people.
So responsibility.
Once you have children, that's going to be more. So obviously there are obstacles, but there's no obstacles that you can't overcome.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when you ask Allah for support and you ask Allah for help. Because who taught us to get married?
Yes.
Who's encouraging us to get married? Mm-hmm. Allah Azza wa Jalla.
Yes.
The Quran, Ahlul Bayt. So definitely Allah will not leave us hanging.
Mm-hmm.
When Allah says, get married early, don't delay marriage, He's going to be there for support. So obviously there's going to be obstacles, but if you're determined, again, let me emphasize, you're not getting married just for the sake of getting married early. No, you want to get married. You found the right person. You're not rushing. I don't want anyone to rush and say, well, I'm 22 now, so I have to get married. No, you find the right person, the person that you're comfortable with, that will make a good spouse, that will make a good mother, that will make a good father. You go ahead and get married mm-hmm. and you rely on Allah, and Allah will be there
mm-hmm.
to help you and support you.
This is a very nice question. Salamad al-Hussein, who also is commenting, he was from yesterday as well. He says, if in young age we marry and get children, who is responsible for raising those children? How can a young boy or girl be able to cultivate the new generation?
Osama, I think, might be thinking of a 15-year-old boy who's having children.
Sarmad. Yeah, oh, sorry, yeah.
Or Sarmad. Or a 17-year-old boy who's having a child. Obviously, at that age, you're still young. No, we're speaking about someone who's in his 20s. who is in his early 20s, mid-20s, mm-hmm. why can't you have children?
Yeah.
Why can't you raise children? In your mid-20s, you're already responsible. You've been through college, you found a job, maybe you've even went through several jobs. You're responsible enough.
Yeah.
You've had your own experience of growing up, of teaching yourself. Now you're going to pass on this experience to your own children.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't see where the obstacle is. I don't see what the problem is. Mm-hmm. Yes, unless Sarmad is thinking of a 15 or 16 year old guy or girl, that's a problem.
Yeah.
But we're speaking about someone who is in his early 20s, mm-hmm. mid-20s.
Yeah. The last question, which is, it's always asked, and many people do message and ask this question on a daily basis. He says, Ali Imran, he says, can a Sayyid girl, meaning Alwiya, marry a non-Sayyid boy? If she can marry, is there any example from Ahlul Bayt family about a girl married from a non-Sayyid boy? I mean, this is, although it's not relevant to wanted to ask, but I mean, you don't need examples from Ahlul Bayt.
A Sayyid female can absolutely marry a non-Sayyid
male. I don't know
male.
Where this phenomena came from.
It's in some cultures. It exists in the Indo-Pakistani
yes,
culture
yeah.
where a female Sayyid has to marry a male Sayyid and she has no other option.
They're 30s, mid-30s.
Yes, and they don't allow girls, their daughters. Yeah. The daughter remains unmarried for several years waiting for a Sayyid to come and propose to her. This is a mistake.
Yeah.
This is wrong. This is oppressive to that female. This does not exist in religion,
mm-hmm.
In Islam. A female Sayyid can marry a non-Sayyid male.
Mm-hmm.
And all Marajah have agreed. There's not a single Marja today that says the daughter of a Sayyid has to marry the son of a Sayyid. No,
mm-hmm.
this thing doesn't exist.
Mm-hmm.
From history, I would have to think, you know, there are some narrations that say that, you know, Imam Ali's daughter, Umm Kulthum,
mm-hmm.
was married to Umar ibn al-Khattab. There are some narrations that say this. Others
Anyways.
Say that these narrations are not accurate.
Yeah.
We have modern examples. There are some Marajah today Sayyid Marajah, who have given their daughters to non-Sayyids.
Yeah. This is clear. We see that.
It doesn't get bigger than that. So this is a myth.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, my advice is to those listening to me, and they have a daughter, a Sayyid daughter, who's not getting married, this is a major problem. Let her marry whoever is a mm-hmm. believer. He doesn't have to be a mm-hmm. Sayyid. Mm-hmm. Doesn't have to be a Sayyid.
Yes.
As long as he's a believer, he's a mu'min, let her get married.
Inshallah. Maybe, inshallah, all the ladies out there find the proper spouse for them. Thank you very much, Sayyidina, for joining us tonight.
My pleasure.
Inshallah, we can continue the discussion tomorrow, but in a different topic. Thank you very much once again. So as a conclusion, marriage has become a huge necessity within our lives. A person who does get married at an early stage finds himself more stable than the person who gets married in a later stage. This is to sum up what we talked about today. Thank you very much. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. No selfies today, Sayyidina.
Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.